We keep your hours with a 24-hour client support center.
Hello and a warm welcome to Captains of Industry. I'm Bronwyn Nielsen. Our captain this evening is celebrated businessman, entrepreneur, and also the founder of proudly African hair care brand, Black Like Me, Herman Mashaba. Thanks very much for your time.
Thanks very much, Bronwyn, for this opportunity.
Let's jump right to the present day before we delve into your history. You are now chairman of the Free Market Foundation. You are basically taking on the Labour Relations Act, and it's going to be a very interesting fight, isn't it?
Absolutely. I think it's, I'm sure everyone in the country is very excited with this, including probably the labor organizations, because I think the reason why we believe we need to really challenge this, we have just over 7 million South Africans unemployed. As a country, we have dismally failed to produce entrepreneurs the last 17 years. So I think to a large extent, these labor laws have really been, responsible for this.
Responsible for the 25% unemployment we're seeing in the country right now?
Absolutely. Actually, it's our employment, obviously, 25%, counting those that are still looking.
That's not even the youth.
Yeah, no. And so we're talking 7.5 million South Africans unemployed, because we've got some of our people who've already given up on looking for jobs. And I think for me, that's obviously one of the scary part of it. I see it, we're turning our people into scavengers. Every day I have to really leave my the house, really look at people scratching the dustbins, pushing this trolleys, and I've actually tried to understand. They're making 50, 70 rands a day. I tell you, I believe as a country, we're hurting these people, and one day they're going to hurt us as well.
Now, you've already widely been called politically incorrect. So when I say this is going to be a fight, it's going to be a big one, isn't it? And you ready for it?
No, I think it's not. Honestly, we don't want to fight with anyone. I think let's all of us concentrate on building this beautiful country. I think I have no reason to really want to fight with anyone. I'm just really concerned with the high unemployment with our country. I'm also concerned with us our failure to produce industrialists, because for as long as we're going to fail to produce entrepreneurs, we're going to have high unemployment like this. We're putting our country at risk. So it's not really a question of really fighting with anyone. Yes, I understand some people, obviously, with vested interest might not really be happy with the steps that we're going to take, but eventually they're the ones who are going to benefit out of this exercise.
And just for clarity, where do you want labor relations in this country to go? What is your end goal?
I think, you know, at the moment we're busy with our legal people to really give us some thoughts in terms of the constitutionality of this, because I think for me as Herman Mashaba, using my common sense without really having a legal brain, I strongly believe, how do we stop people from working? I mean, this whole issue about the CCMA, that anyone can take you to the CCMA, there's no risk to them. You know, I mean, go out and talk to entrepreneurs, black entrepreneurs in the townships without having proper HR departments, how they are being harassed and get eventually forced to really get out of business. We look at our people who've really not had an opportunity to work for the last 5-10 years. That's when you can obviously see the pain. And I believe, how do we stop these people from working? It's obviously these issues about the minimum wages and so forth.
Too difficult for companies to employ. You've been quoted as saying that people do not start a company to employ people. They start a company to make money.
I think, Bronwyn, we need to really be honest with ourselves. I don't know, maybe that's how I was born, not to really try and really misinform people. I think let us really be honest with ourselves. Anywhere in the world, South Africa included, there's no way any businessman will go into business because he wants to employ other people. It doesn't work like that. Let's just really use common sense. But at the end of the day, that is why it's the responsibility of the government to encourage entrepreneurs and business people to employ. But the thing is, as a businessman, it's not your primary objective. It's employment is part and parcel of doing whatever you want to really do. And that's what we need to really encourage.
Are you receiving the necessary support from business in South Africa?
I think a lot of people are interested in this, particularly those people in the townships and the villages who are unemployed. You know, I get calls literally every day. The other day, I really met someone who's been out of work for the last 10 years. Someone in his mid-50s, he approached me and says, "Mr. Mashaba, I read your article. Please, you need to really help us, because I've been unemployed for the last 10 years. Since the new South Africa came, I was working, obviously I was active in labor issues, Eventually, my business, our business had to really retrench me because we kept on demanding, and the business couldn't really sustain this any longer. So some of us lost our jobs. So it's been 10 years, and I see this trend happening all the time. More and more of our people coming into the township is not really working. And he says, you know what? I believe really, I feel I was betrayed because I believed that I had the right to demand and demand. I did not realize that I've got limits how far I can really push. So these are the type of people who are really coming to us as, please, we really need to really protect this country.
What about other captains of industry? Are they uniting forces?
Well, I think I am personally on the roadshow really trying to really get the business community to really understand the danger that we're facing. And at the end of
the day... Can you build up the Free Market Foundation to something that everybody is going to take seriously?
Actually, I'm having this discussion this morning, I had a big discussions with one of the agencies. I'm really working out on a campaign where I can really get every South African who believe in free market principles to join the organization as members. That guy in Alexander who sells tomatoes on the side of the street, I really want him to really have a Free Market Foundation card and actually be proud of it. And so that if someone comes in and really want to come out with a different ideology, can say, look, you know what, this is the system that I believe in. And so we will obviously one of these days launch this big campaign. Because we're not there for big business, we're not there for small business, we're there for South Africans. We want South Africans to work and prosper because that's the only way this country can really be protected going forward.
Now let's jump into your story because it is one of the most inspiring stories in the entrepreneurial field in South Africa at this moment. And that is, of course, the story of Black Like Me. But let's go right back to growing up in the township, to your father dying when you were 2 years old, to your mother, a domestic worker, having to look after five children, and how that has shaped the person that you are today.
Yeah, I think Bronwyn and I was extremely lucky to have survived because unfortunately a big percentage of people I grew up with could not really survive the environment in which we had to live. So that is really what inspired me and actually first compelled me to really write this book. You know, to really come out with things that some people would feel uncomfortable to obviously really discuss out there in the public domain. But I feel very strongly that if people can really take some learnings out of that, so that I think all of us as parents today must obviously really ensure that our kids cannot really go through the type of lifestyle that Herman Mashaba was brought into. Because I was just really lucky that I survived that.
And you are so honest in your book. You talk about the fact that you sell drugs.
Yeah, no.
You were a backstreet gambler. You used to take the money off the gardeners, effectively, gamble it off them. It was tough.
Yeah, because, you know, Bronwyn and I keep sharing this with South Africa and the world, that, you know, I actually grew up actually thinking that white people are evil creatures because of listening to parents relate and people around me relating their experiences. And when I was 14, 15, my peers started going into the white neighborhoods to go and work in their gardens. And then they come back in the afternoon, start relating their experiences. I then decided at a very early stage of my life to say, look, I'm not going to make contact with these evil creatures. But what is interesting is that once obviously I started interacting with people and discovered the world of goodwill that actually exists in human beings, that it's a question of people being misled by political leadership, and that people were misled by the political leadership. And the very same trend might actually happen to us right now in our country, where we have to really find ways to really bring our people together so that, you know what, 10, 20 years down the line, it'll really be unfortunate if we can still talk about ourselves as white and black South Africans. I'm working towards really ensuring that we build South Africans, not white or black South Africans.
The gambling paid for your schooling. And then you wanted to become a lawyer, but you weren't accepted into the course.
Yeah, and unfortunately, I go into the university. They accepted me to study the law. First week of orientation, something that obviously I think as a youth, I made a terrible mistake. 1976, I decided to put away my Afrikaans book, only concentrated Afrikaans during Afrikaans classes. And even up to the day when I wrote my exams, never interested. Afrikaans book only dealt with it during Afrikaans classes. But then I failed dismally. But fortunate enough for me, because I'd done extremely well on other subjects, I still managed to get university exemption. But then reality don't. Then the first week of orientation, they realized how terrible my Afrikaans were. And the lecturers were fair with me. Says, look, Herman, you're going to be making a terrible mistake because in this country, for you to really be a lawyer, you need Afrikaans as one of your subjects. And I had to unfortunately change direction.
You changed direction, but very quickly you moved into a couple of dead-end jobs. Supermarket, furniture store, and then into sales. And that was your calling.
Oh, yeah, that was really the break for me because, you know, you can imagine second year of my studies, the university goes closed down. One morning, 6 o'clock, surrounded by the army, and we were given 6 hours to leave. And I did not even have a cent on that day. But fortunate enough, as a group, we helped each other, and I managed to leave. Then you go back. Now I don't have education. I don't have experience. And now I have to really go into that hostile world which I dreaded. And I had to then find a way. How am I going to get my liberation? And that's when I decided the commercial world is going to be the way. But then at the same time, South Africa, at the time, says, you as a black man, no chance for you. You cannot go into business. And I decided, with or without this legislative framework, I'm going to do it. And that's how I bought a car, then started gambling, another now different kind of gambling, selling glasses, linen, and so forth.
What is it that you need to be a salesperson? And how did you know it was your calling? I mean, obviously, you started making money from it, but what is it that you were doing right?
I don't know. I don't know. I'm a born salesman. I think if you look back at my days as a gambler, I used to really gamble in gambling dens where school going kids were not allowed, and I would really be there and actually be the owner of the school. And so for me, actually selling and interacting with people, probably it's a gift that I've got that is in my DNA. It's anywhere where I've got to really work with people and sell them. But firstly, I've got to really believe in the product that I'm selling. So, and I honestly and deeply love environment where we make money, and because it's through making money that one can get one's independence.
Now take us to the black hair care range and what happened then, because you then built a dream around a gap in the market that you saw, and you approached a pharmacist who was working with you, Johan Creel.
What a wonderful human being, yes.
Not often a black man will at that time have approached a white man with the story.
1984, you take a chance. But one thing I've realized, I've always really been a very proactive person in life. When you really see an opportunity and you can see there's danger going forward, I always like to really be proactive. And I think for me, approaching Johan, We had no choice. We needed someone with the right type of skills to really assist us with this. We wanted his white skin to really help deal with the official side of it. But I had an opportunity, obviously, interacting with the owner of the business to really learn that Johan is a real hardcore entrepreneur. So, you know what, I thought I'm going to talk to someone that comes from the same DNA as I am. And fortunate enough, Johan bought into our dream. And we're fortunate enough, Walter Dube, a businessman from Mawopane, we approached him with our funding requirements and all that.
It was 30,000
rands. And it was
you launched in 1985 with 30,000 rand.
That was a lot of money at the time. Walter took a gamble, and fortunately paid for everyone. So I think these are the people I obviously feel grateful for having touched my life throughout my development. And
so quickly you paid off that 30,000 rand.
Yeah, we're lucky. We had 3 years to pay. It was very expensive funding, prime plus 10. And actually at the time, you can check, the 1985 January, prime was at 21. So we're paying prime plus 10 plus 25% shareholding in the business. But for us at the time was the cheapest funding we could ever get, because you couldn't go to the banks those days as a black business person.
And then immediately you started making money and back to upgrading cars, lifestyle. You enjoyed spending your money, didn't you?
Oh, yeah, absolutely, because coming from our environment, we started making money and we want to buy a nice car and whatever. But I was fortunate enough that I realized these things were not important in my life.
And you had a fantastic partner,
Connie. And I think my wife, that's really the reason why I keep saying to South Africa and the world that I was really fortunate. One decision that I actually treasure in my life is the decision to get married at the age of 22, because I needed protection. And Connie provided the shield, because I don't really believe I would have made any strides without Connie around. If you look at my kind of background, you've read my book. I mean, for us, life was, we used to live for today. you know.
But it wasn't all plain sailing. You've had very tough times. Enter 1993. The factory burnt down.
Not burnt down. Someone touched it. It
was torched it?
No, it was torched. It was not an accidental fire.
I missed that fact.
It was arson.
And then insurance refused to pay out.
Yeah, not pay out. No, I lost. Obviously, they paid out, but not anyway. It lost to the actual value of what I lost. And obviously, the new South Africa started, and that's where. Fortunate enough, you know, for me, coming from my background, I've always believed in saving. I don't just live for today any longer. I'm always worried about tomorrow. Like today, I've already had my meal and I'm already covered. But
we're taking
for sure,
a short break, and we are coming back to this exciting story. As I said, we'll see you on the other side of this break with more from Herman Mashaba, one of our great entrepreneurs. Stay tuned.